Welcome everybody to this first plenary lecture. And it's a great pleasure to introduce our first plenary speaker. It's Tobias Witt. And maybe let me say something about his career. So he did his PhD 2001 in Mainz. And then he had several positions in Minnesota and in Gießen. He got his habilitation 2007 in Gießen. And this habilitation also received an award. And since then, he's working in Frankfurt. And he will talk about curves and surfaces with constant non-local mean curvature. So let's welcome Professor Witt.
Okay, can you, I think, yeah, I have a very loud voice, by the way, so I hope it will be not too loud for everybody. So first, let me say, dear presidents of mathematical societies, dear organizers, dear all, I'd just like to thank you first for the invitation to give a talk here and also for this really unique hospitality I've experienced already here in Korea. It's just a great pleasure to be here and something really, really unique to be here in Seoul, in Korea. I would like to talk about a joint work with three colleagues. And this work is related to three papers we wrote quite recently, so it's also a recent topic. So basically, one could say 10 years ago, it all started. And well, I got on this track maybe 4 years ago. So really recent. And this is joint work with Xavier Cabré and Joan Solar Morales from Barcelona and with Mustafa Faure from AIM Senegal in Bourg. And the aim of the talk, I hope you can read it, is to give you an excursion or to provide an excursion from standard to non-local mean curvature. So I will start by explaining some analytical aspects or reviewing some analytical aspects of mean curvature. Then I will try to make my way to non-local mean curvature, try to motivate it and discuss elementary properties. Then I will focus on hypersurfaces with constant mean curvatures, and if time permits, I will also discuss some open problems. Okay, so let's start. As I said, the topic is maybe just started just 10 years ago, but, well, mean curvature and related aspects, this started many centuries ago. And let me start by saying that starting from 744, locally area minimizing surfaces, so which you can see in soap films, were first studied by Leonhard Euler, Joseph-Louis Lagrange, Jean-Baptiste Mézier, and Heinrich Scherk. And the local equilibrium condition for such a soap film is, or let's say in today's mathematical language, a smooth locally area-minimizing surface has vanishing mean curvature. So this is what we call a minimal surface. But back then, Lagrange was the first to formulate in two dimensions the condition of extremality as a PDE, anti-generalized work by Euler back then, who did a rotational invariant case. Then Meusnier realized that there's a connection with principal curvatures, and then Sophie Germain suggested to use the name mean curvature for the average or sum of principal curvatures. So let me just review the first examples, which are reported of complete embedded minimal surfaces. So Leonhard Euler found the catenoid. Then Meusnier found the helicoid, and he really calculated that it satisfies the equation provided by Lagrange. And then, almost 60 years later, so there was a quite a gap, came up, the next examples by Heinrich Scherk. And we will see the first two examples later again in the talk. So let me review mean curvature. I think this is probably what everybody knows, how the mean curvature of an oriented C2 hypersurface is given. So it's given as a trace of the Weingarten map or the sum of principal curvatures. Yeah, you can say that's an easy definition, but for me, this is already too algebraic. Too algebraic. I want a more analytical description. And I want to give a different characterization, which is for which I, for the moment, need to write M as a boundary, which I can do locally also, of an open set of class C2. And then I can say the mean curvature at a point on the boundary just measures locally how much of the complement is in the neighborhood of this point and how much of the set is in the neighborhood of this point. So if you take a small ball and you measure the volume outside and the volume inside, you subtract and you suitably normalize and let the limit epsilon tend to zero, and you have to normalize with 1 over epsilon, otherwise you get zero, that's obvious for C2. And then you get precisely the mean curvature. And I would like this, to write this as an integral over this function tau e. And I would like to call this the signed indicator function, and I would like you to remember this function because it will play a big role in this talk. So for such an open set e, we call tau e the signed indicator function. It's like taking it's 1 on the complement and minus 1 on the set E itself. Now, we were discussing minimal surfaces on the first slide. So what has this to do with minimal surfaces? So if you take a hypersurface and you perturb it locally, so you can ask, what is the rate of change of perimeter? What is the rate of change of surface area? And this is very classical. The first variation of surface area with regard to perturbation by a vector field is given just as the integral over the surface times the mean curvature, and you take the vector field scalar product, the projection on the normal of your vector field V. This is the first variation. Now, and if you suppose that your surface is stationary under each of these vector fields, which you can write down, so take all, let's say, vector fields in C infinity or C2 with compact support, then you get the local equilibrium condition that the mean curvature has to vanish, right? If this integral vanishes for all such vector fields V, then H has to vanish, and this is what we call a minimal surface. In the case where M is the boundary of some, let's say, bounded set E, you can also vary the perimeter function, which is just the surface area of the boundary. And you can do this subject to the constraint that you keep the volume fixed. And then what you get is the mean curvature must be constant. This will be your equilibrium condition, as we can see in this soap bubble here. And then we call M a constant mean curvature surface. So this is all very classical, but I would like to review it. And then there's something more recent. You can, and it is the connection of mean curvature with the movement of interfaces driven by diffusion. So for this, we consider the classical heat equation, and as an initial datum, we take our function tau e, so the signed indicator function, which is 1 on the complement and minus 1 on our set e, which now, again, is supposed to be an open bound set with smooth boundary. And stochastically, you can describe this solution which you get as follows. You consider Brownian motions of the Wiener process, and if you would like to see what is the solution at a point Tx, so then you take your point x and you take a Brownian path starting at this point x, and you look after time t whether you are in the set E or whether you are in the complement. And if you're in the set E, you give the value minus 1. If you're in the complement, you give the value 1. And then you take the expectation value, so the mean over all Brownian path, and this is what you get as your solution. And then you have a moving interface. So you take the zero set of your solution, and you would like to ask how it moves. And there's a theorem by Evans on the initial movement. The initial movement has a velocity, which is just the negative direction of curvature. yeah, in the normal direction. So the normal velocity, the velocity in the normal direction is just the negative curvature. So for, let's say, a very short time, the interface moves like the mean curvature flow with up to higher order corrections. This is a theorem by Evans, but it builds on previous work around at the same time, for instance, by Bench Merriman and Osher, and they have used this observation, in a sense, to approximate the mean curvature flow by the heat equation in such a way that you start with such a front. You just take the heat equation for a very small time, and then you replace your function, which you get again by taking it one or minus one on the positive part, one on the positive part and minus one on the negative part, and then you start again. And then you get an algorithm, and this algorithm approximates the mean curvature flow. Now let's do something really crazy. Let's do the same thing with the jump process. For me, this is crazy, I have to say, this idea, but I didn't have this idea. This was the idea of Cavarelli and Tsouganidis. In 2008, they considered the fractional heat equation. So where instead of the Laplacian, you take a fractional power, so just the operator with Fourier symbol modulus to the alpha, power alpha, or spectral theoretic power alpha half of the Laplacian. And this is also related to a stochastic process, and this process is called the symmetric or isotropic alpha stable process. Okay. So what is this alpha stable process? I'm an analyst, so if you have really good questions about the alpha stable process, and you can come later to me, and I tell you the people who you can ask, okay? But I have to say something. So the alpha stable process is a pure jump process, but it still is related to the Brownian motion in such a way that it is subordinated to the Brownian motion, so the Brownian motion path play a big role, and the jumps are just in time. So you jump in time, and follow the path of Brownian motion, but you take shortcuts by jumping. And then you have very, very, very many, many little jumps and very short waiting times, which you cannot really see. So it's maybe good that it's not, maybe you cannot see it that well. So you can hardly distinguish this little, on this scale, the difference. But then you have also some larger jumps, which really you can see and which allow you to take shortcuts. And all this you have to think of as a scale invariant jump process in time. So this is what it makes so special. And again, we have a moving interface. And Cafarelli and Tsouganidis then proved that the initial normal velocity of this interface equals a quantity, which is still up to a constant, the mean curvature, the negative mean curvature, if alpha is greater than or equal to 1, but if alpha is less than 1, then it drastically changes. Then it becomes a non-local quantity, which I've written here. So it's like a principal value integral with a function tau e and a weight which depends on the distance to your point x where you consider this on the boundary. And this is the birthday of non-local mean curvature, because this is precisely the quantity, the non-local mean curvature. And I will just explain to you in a second what this Cauchy principal value is here. Let me just say at this point, what you can see, it has to do with the characterization of classical mean curvature I showed you on one of the first slides. Because again, you integrate over this function tau epsilon. So you measure how much you find in the complement on the set and how much you find inside your set. But it's not local, because you measure at a different scale what is far away and what is close to your point x. Okay? So in this situation, so if you have an open set with C2 boundary and you take alpha between 0 and 1, you define the non-local mean curvature, you could say of degree or of exponent alpha, but I will avoid this for the talk, and it's also not used in the literature, as precisely this principal value integral, so which means you have to cut out a small ball, and then you integrate around x, and then you consider the limit as epsilon tends to zero. And you have to do it because you need cancellations, otherwise clearly this integral cannot be defined in Lebesgue sense because the singularity is too strong. And these cancellations you get under the assumption that your boundary is of class C2, and in fact you can do a little bit less. So the notion of non-local mean curvature can be credited to 3 papers basically, and probably in all of these papers it's not really called the non-local mean curvature, but after that it has been mainly used as a name. You can recover the classical curvature from the non-local mean curvature as a limit as you take alpha, the limit from alpha, taking the limit alpha to 1. You just have to renormalize, and here you renormalize with 1 minus alpha over the volume of the n minus 1 dimensional unit ball. And also, you have enough cancellations for the non-local mean curvature to be well defined already if your boundary is of class C1 beta, so it is in a Hölder space, so slightly less regular than C2 would also work. Okay, somewhere between C1 alpha and C2 would be enough in order to define this integral. If you don't like Hölder spaces, for the moment you can think of C2, that's enough. But then it's a natural question to ask if the non-local mean curvature also arises in the local equilibrium, as a local equilibrium condition associated to the variation of something, maybe a parameter type functional. And this is also the case because the non-local mean curvature arises as first variation of the fractional parameter. Okay, let me explain you what the fractional parameter is. Let's take a bounded set, again, just to be very cautious with C2 boundary, we don't really have to do this, but let's do this for the moment. And then we define the fractional parameter. It's a double integral, and a double integral which somehow counts the interaction of E with its complement. So somehow you have to think of that E interacts in some way with its complement, so every point of E interacts with every point in the complement, and the strength of interaction is given by this weight. And then you sum over all of these interactions, and this is the fractional parameter. So you can think of this as a type of prototype of a non-local interfacial energy or interaction energy between E and its complement. And what you can see, and this is more subtle than it seems, that your fractional parameter in some way interpolates between the classical parameter and the Lebesgue measure. But we have to be careful because the integral as it's written here will diverge if you take alpha to 1 and if you take the limit alpha to 0. So in both cases you have to renormalize with an alpha dependent constant in order to get the Lebesgue measure or the parameter. And there's something also very interesting. As you can see, this fractional parameter clearly is invariant if you change from E to its complement. But here I say if you take the limit alpha to 0, you get the measure of E. So this is a little bit subtle, but this also in this way just works if one of the sets is bounded as finite measure. Okay? So it's not as... there's some work to do in order to prove that this parameter functionally interpolates between the classical parameter and Lebesgue measure. And this is basically due to the authors I've named here. Now, the first variation of the fractional parameter, again, taking the variation of my set E by a vector field and checking how does my parameter change. And then I take the first variation, and what do I get? I get the fractional mean curvature times, again, the vector field in normal direction, and I have to integrate. Okay, this has been proved in different cases or in different... under, let's say, in a weak form by Caffarelli, Rocchetoffo, Savin, and in a strong form by Figali, Fusco, Maggi, and Millot, Morini in 2015, and also for more general kernels. So let us discuss some elementary properties of non-local mean curvature, because I want you to also get a bit used to it. First of all, it's a kind of maybe annoying that it's for the moment just defined for boundaries of open sets. But this is not really a restriction, because you can use an integration by parts argument to rewrite the non-local mean curvature as an integral over the surface itself. Okay? And for this, you just need an oriented surface. You need a normal vector field. And the expression is given on the right-hand side. So it's you have to integrate by parts separately in E. And the complement, because you have a principal value integral, you also have to first cut off the singularity and then in the end let the epsilon tend to zero. So you have and I would call this the geometric representation, because it just relies on the surface itself, not on being a boundary of something. And the right-hand side, as I said, extends to oriented C1 beta hypersurfaces. Now we know that classical curvature scales with 1 over R. So if you blow up my set on the scale R, the mean curvature scales as 1 over R. The known local mean curvature, corresponding to the exponent alpha, scales with the factor r to the minus alpha. And let me recall some further elementary properties. We have a strong global comparison property. Suppose you have two sets, suitably regular, which have a common boundary point. Then if one set is included in the other, and the sets are not equal, then directly you have a strict comparison of non-local mean curvature. You see the contrast to the classical mean curvature in this picture. The two sets, the boundaries of these two sets at the point X have the same classical mean curvature, but they have different non-local mean curvatures, simply because the non-local mean curvature also takes into account what it sees of the set E, or in this case E2, far away. So this is a stronger property than you have it for the classical curvature, and it's a very useful property. On the other hand, you don't have a local comparison property, and you cannot expect it. So if your set E1 is not included in E2, not contained in E2, but you just know that the intersection with a small ball around your boundary point of E1 is included in the same intersection with E2, then you cannot deduce that the non-local mean curvatures are ordered in the same way. Well, because the non-local mean curvature sees also the part of E2, or in this case of E1, which is outside of this little ball. And if this is really large, then the comparison fails. Right? There's something which you directly want to do if you have a curvature notion. You want to see what it is on graphs. Take a graph of a function. So let's consider a function from Rn to R. And then we have the classical mean curvature, which assigns to a point the mean curvature to a point x, the mean curvature at the point x, ux, which has this form right here. You can look for the same operator just in the non-local notion. Well, it looks slightly more complicated. So what you can see here is a quasi-linear non-local operator of order 1 plus alpha. So if you forget about the q, you have the so-called fractional Laplacian of order with this 1 plus alpha. But the q function is a little bit delicate, because first of all, you have this different quotient, and this difference quotient has a modulus in the denominator. And that's a problem, because it means that this quantity cannot be extended continuously to the diagonal unless n is equal to 1, because then we have still a square in the definition of the q function, and then it is just the derivative squared on the diagonal. But otherwise, this is an anisotropic term, and this cannot be extended continuously to the diagonal. This is a little bit of a problem. And the other thing is, the other warning, the graph case is not so helpful in the non-local case, because in the local case, you can reduce all local computations to graphs. You can always write something as locally as a graph, a C2 hypersurface. This is not true in the non-local case anymore. Okay, so let me now define the notion of non-local minimal surfaces and CMC surfaces. A non-local minimal surface is a surface where H alpha is identically zero, and the CMC first surface is one where H alpha is a constant. By a result of Barrios, Figali, and Valdinocchi, if you have the C1 beta regularity, you automatically have C infinity. This is very helpful. Well, in the case where M is the boundary of an open bounded set, the non-local minimality is, as we discussed, the equilibrium condition for the variation of fractional parameter. In the case where the set is not bounded, you can still consider local variations of your parameter, but then you have to renormalize it, because otherwise it will be, you have to vary infinite infinite quantities. And this is what you usually do, is you subtract formally the interaction of something which is outside a fixed bounded set. In such a way, you can consider a non-local plateau problem. I will not discuss it here, but it has been studied by Caffarelli, Rocco, Geoffrey, Savine. Let me come maybe to the nicest result of the talk. First of all, Alexandrov proved in 1958 that if you have a closed embedded hypersurface of constant mean curvature, then it has to be a round sphere. So this is why we know that soap bubbles are round. But we knew this before, but Alexandrov confirmed it. And how about non-local mean curvature? There is no difference. The same thing I just formulated for boundaries of a non-empty bounded open set. Set is missing here, such that the boundary is of class C1 beta, and H alpha is constant, then E is a ball. This has been independently obtained by us and by Giralo, Figali, Maggi, Novaga, and both papers were uploaded on archive on the same day, on March 2nd, 2015. You probably wonder how this works, but it works. Okay. In contrast to Alexandrov's result, connectedness is not assumed in the non-local case, which is what you, because you have the interaction between different components in the non-local case, this is maybe natural that you don't need to assume it. And the proof is based on the moving plane method. The general strategy is the same in both papers, but some details are different. So on, you could see that on March 2nd, the first thing we did was check the other paper, right? Okay, and Giralolo, Figali, Maggi, and Novaga also provide a quantitative version of this result. But I will not discuss this here. Let me just give an outline of the proof of this result. So it's based on the moving plane method, which is due to Alexandrov in this original form, and it's very useful. So under these assumptions we have, if we have a bounded oriented hypersurface, we can always write it as a boundary of some open set. And we only have to show that this set is symmetric after translation with respect to X1, because then we can take rotations of this set itself and prove the same thing, and we do this for all rotations, and we have that it has to be a ball, and the boundary has to be a sphere. So we just have to prove symmetry with respect to E1. So let us introduce a little bit of notation. For any lambda in R, we consider the half space X1 equal to R, and we denote by Q lambda the reflection at this half space. And there's a basic geometric observation that one of the following has to happen at one point lambda star. So what you do is you take your original set, you reflect it, and you move it very far to the right, such that both sets which you can get are disjoint. And then you start moving the reflection back in lambda. And you move it back until one of two things happens. The first thing which can happen is you touch the original set from inside, And the second thing is that you have a non-transversal intersection. So at some point, E1 is in the tangent space of your surface, which means it also has to be in the tangent space of the reflected one. And then what you do is you prove in both cases that in both cases, you must have symmetry. In the classical case where M has constant mean curvature, you can use maximum principles for quasi-linear elliptic equations to prove this, and you have to do it in the interior and in the boundary situation. And for this, it is sufficient to write M locally as a graph. But I already told you we cannot use this in the non-local case for various reasons. In particular, just to write it as a graph will not be sufficient. So let me explain you briefly how you do it in the non-local case. In fact, it's not really more difficult. So case one, you have interior touching. What you can do is you have a constant mean curvature, so the curvature of your reflected set will be the same as of your original set. So you take the difference, and you write this difference as a common integral, and then you have these functions tau e and tau of this reflected set, e lambda star. And as you know how it's defined equal to 1 on the complement and minus 1 on the set itself. So if you're on the intersection, the difference will be 0, and of the complement of all, it will also be 0. So the only areas which you have to look are these here, so E, where you subtract E lambda star, and the opposite. And on the one set, it will be 2, and on the other set, it will be minus 2. You can clearly write this, again, with the reflection as one integral, and then you look at this point X, and you have to see if you take a point Y here, and you take the reflected point here, to see that the distance to Y is certainly smaller than to the reflected point, and therefore this integral has a sign, and it must be 0, so equality must hold, and this forces that the distance must be the same, and this is precisely the case if you have symmetry. Non-transversal intersection, in this case, it's slightly more difficult, and here are the technical part of this proof, because you need the following lemma. If your boundary is of class C to beta, then you can differentiate the non-local mean curvature in tangent directions. And the formula which you can see here looks very innocent. It looks just like differentiating under the integral. And, well, usually it works, right? Differentiating under the integral should usually work. And it does in this case as well, but it requires really 3 pages of proof in our case, because what you have here is you have a principal value integral, and you have principal value integral with respect to a singularity at x. So if you differentiate with respect to x, your singularity is moving. So it's always bad if you have to integrate such a thing where your singularity is, if you have to differentiate in the direction where the singularity is moving. So the first thing you have to do, you have to write this integral, rewrite it with a fixed singularity, but then you have your x and your function tau e, and which is not differentiable. But you can get around all this, and you can prove this lemma. Once you have it, you can complete in a somehow related way, and due to lack of time, I will not explain the details here, but this is the main part. So basically, instead of considering the mean curvature itself, you now consider the derivative in E1 direction, because we know that E1 is in the tangent space, so we can do it, and again we get symmetry. So let me remark that there's a long evolution of the moving plane method, and somehow we came a little bit close to the beginning, because it all started with Alexandrov, and then we are back to the non-local Alexandrov. But there were many other variants, and in particular, this was a geometric variant, so for sets, and there were many variants for functions, in particular for solutions to second-order PDEs. And let me just mention that At some point, also fractional problems had been studied. It started with the work of Birkner, Lopez Mbela, and Verkolbinger. And then also we did extend this also to parabolic fractional PDE, which is basically proving asymptotic symmetry of positive solutions. And there's some other related work by Barrios, Montoro, and Chunzi for this. So it remains to consider unbounded surfaces of constant non-local mean curvature, because we already know that the bounded ones are trivial. These are balls. So what we have here, I told you that we will see these pictures again. We have the catenoid and the helicoid. Question is, are there non-local counterparts of these minimal surfaces? Well, the first observation is that the helicoid is also a non-local minimal surfaces, and this even for every alpha. And why is this? This is because of symmetry. The helicoid has such a rich symmetry, and as we heard yesterday, symmetry is your friend, and here it's a really good friend, because if you fix a point on the helicoid, you can always find an involution of the helicoid which keeps the distance to this point fixed. And this is the main reason why this non-local mean curvature, no matter what your exponent is, will also be zero for the helicoid. So how about the catenoid? Well, there's a paper by Davila, Del Pino, and Wey. It's 92 pages long, and they shortened it to 75 pages for the Journal of Differential Geometry. And what they do is they construct, in particular, a non-local catenoid, and these pictures from their paper. And this non-local catenoid does not have the hyperbolic cosine as an asymptotic, but just a linear asymptotic. And what they also saw is they have something else. They have a two-sheet minimal surface, which certainly cannot happen in the local case. You cannot have such a minimal surface in the local case, with the same asymptotics, where you just close the catenoid, the non-local one, in another way. This is related to the existence of a non-local minimal cone, but let me just say that these are really difficult constructions. So I want to present an own result again, and this is related to Delaunay surfaces. In 1841, Delaunay classified all constant mean curvature surfaces of rotation in R3. If you take them to be 2π periodic, what you get is the so-called undoloids, and they form a one-parameter family, and they bifurcate from a straight cylinder until they meet tangent spheres, like a chain of tangent spheres. And what is very nice geometrically, if you take the profile curves of these surfaces of revolution, you can just find them by rolling an ellipse. And you have to take the focus, and you have to trace it. And if you do this, you get precisely the profile functions of these Delaunay surfaces. This is just the embedded case. Also interesting, you can reduce it to the first order, the condition to a first order ODE, which you cannot solve explicitly, but in parametric way you can do it. And certainly the parameter is the arc length of the ellipse. So the one-parameter family of surfaces converges to a chain of touching spheres, and you can do something similar in higher dimensions. But certainly you cannot do this in dimension 2, because in dimension 2, certainly you must have curves. And curves of constant curvature are either straight lines or they are circles. There's nothing more. And you cannot bifurcate from straight lines. In the non-local case, we can. So let us consider cylindrical graphs of this form, and we have the following result. It's just a perturbative result, which says we can perturb the straight cylinder by keeping the non-local mean curvature constant. And the perturbation with respect to the cosine function, as you can see in the line below, for the profile function. So we start with something straight, with a constant function as a profile function, and we perturb a first order in the cosine. And we can do this by keeping the non-local mean curvature constant. And this we can also do in dimension 2. So in this case, we have double curves. And this is related to the fact that the upper part of your curve sees also the lower part of your curve, because the problem is non-local. On the other hand, the construction is still much simpler in the case n equal to 2 than in the higher dimensional case. And I don't have much, I just have 2 minutes, right? So I have to keep this very short. Let me just say, what is the endpoint of your branch, the Delaunay branch, if it exists? Well, it's not not so clear, because touching spheres do not have non-local mean curvature. Even if you take these joint spheres arranged on an array like this, you cannot have non-local mean curvature, constant. But you can ask the question, if you can, is it possible to deform, such a chain of spheres in order to keep the non-local mean curvature constant? And this we can do, and I have to, sorry, I have to rush. Just look at the picture below. We can perturb the spheres in this way, such that they have non-local mean curvature. And we can compute the change, so the spherical we take spherical graphs and we can compute the change up to this order given here, depending on the distance of the spheres. And these constants are explicit, and just to show you that they are explicit, given in terms of the Riemann zeta function and the spherical fractional Laplacian and its eigenvalues. So to finish, because I have not much time, let me just point out the main steps of the construction. So you start by computing the non-local mean curvature on cylindrical and spherical graphs. And then comes the hardest part. You have to prove smoothness of your non-local mean curvature operator. This is really hard. In the case of perturbed cylinders, then you follow a standard route of nonlinear analysis. You linearize at constant functions, study zero crossing of eigenvalues, corresponding eigenspaces, restrict to a subspace of symmetric functions to avoid multiplicity, and then apply the Crandall-Rabinowitz bifurcation theorem, which is the basic bifurcation theorem if you have just one simple eigenvalue. In the case of perturbed chains, you have to linearize at infinity, basically saying you have a single sphere, all the others are far away. Then you have to restrict again to avoid to symmetric functions to avoid degeneracy, apply the implicit function theorem, and compute the coefficients. Unfortunately, I think my time is over. I cannot go into detail. Let me just mention that this is an expression for the non-local mean curvature of cylindrical graphs. The only thing I want you to see here is, if you plug in a constant function, you get out a constant. Well, this is true. You plug in a constant, you get a constant here. And this means, and in fact, you get a positive constant. That's not so easy to see, but, and this means already the straight cylinder, even in dimension 2, has positive non-local mean curvature. So the double curve already has positive constant mean curvature. Okay. Then we have to look at the linearization. I'm sorry, my time is really up. And let me just show the eigenvalues of the linearization have a very nice asymptotics. And we have monotonicity. So the linearization certainly depends on the constant itself. So if I make the cylinder very thick or very thin, and all the conditions are satisfied in order to apply the Crandall-Rabinowitz theorem. So let me finish with open problems. So far we could not find a global branch, and it would also be interesting to see, is there a limiting Delaunay, let's say, band, so in two dimensions, which somehow separates the connected sets from the disconnected sets. But something has been tried also by Davila, Di Piero, Valdinocchi, and Wei, and what they have done successfully is they have applied a variational approach to non-local Delaunay-type surfaces. So they just consider a minimization problem for the fractional perimeter with a local prescribed fixed volume. But what they could not do, and what nobody can do up to now, is to prove the regularity. So it's not clear in which sense these surfaces should be of constant non-local mean curvature. This is really open. And let me say that this is the main open problem for the variational approach. So how do you prove regularity? Usually what you would like to do is first to prove non-local, constant non-local mean curvature in a kind of viscosity sense. But even this is open, and the regularity, even in viscosity sense, is also open. So let me just finish here, and thank you for your attention. And provide some references.
Thank you very much for this nice talk. So are there questions or remarks?
Geometric meaning.
When you ask geometric meaning in a sense, can it be somehow derived from non-local principal curvatures or such a thing? There is some way to also define it. What you're lacking is the linear algebra. You cannot get the non-local mean curvature really just somehow. Why there is not so much geometry so far is that we don't have, that we can just write it as a sum of something, right? So it's we don't have all this linear algebra to get this. The geometric meaning at this point is just, it has to do with this stationarity for the fractional parameter, and it has to do with these interfacial energies. So you want this to be locally stationary for these interfacial energies, the fraction parameter.
Thank you very much. So are there other questions, remarks? So then let's thank the speaker again.